Wow, you guys can talk. Holy cow. Now I'm going to torture you for a little bit. No, this is going to be a relatively brief talk tonight. Just I guess as a prelude, as far as our understanding of the effects of hydropeaking on the ecology of the river, we're really at the tip of the iceberg right now, and what I'm going to talk about tonight will be like the few little ice crystals on the top of that tip. I mean, we've got a long way to go. I'm excited about what we're doing, but we've got a lot to learn. So tonight, I think most of you know that just from what you've heard in the emails, we're still in the process of analyzing these data. It's probably a few months out before we have the biological data. So tonight I really got some temperature data to show you. And so in order to fill this out a little bit, I thought that I would give some context to this, some broader context to this. You know, everyone's asking, what are the effects of hydropeaking on the ecology of the Deerfield River? What do we know about it? Well, the fact of the matter is, we don't know a lot, because as several of you have alluded to tonight, no one's really spent much time looking at it. I mean, you think that this being such a undisturbed watershed and such a popular fishery and such a beautiful part of the state that it would garner the attention that we all know it deserves. But it just, for whatever reason, the main stem in particular, the tributaries get surveyed by the state, both DEP and Mass DFW, but the main stem really is very much neglected, if you want me to put it bluntly. So the work that we're doing right now is an attempt to fill in those gaps, especially ahead of relicensing here. So the timing is very serendipitous in that respect. So with all of that being said, tonight's presentation is about understanding the effects of dams and hydropeaking on the ecology of the Deerfield River, and really kind of a characterization of where we are now and where we really need to go from here, so that we as a group, when I say we, I guess I'm talking rather inclusively now. I'm a DRWA board member, I'm a TU member. You know, we as conservation organizations, where do we want to see the river going, and what opportunities do we have to shape that direction? So I guess this might be a little bit elementary to many of us, but I thought I'd start with some of the real basics here. We've got here two hydrographs. I think we all know which one is the hydrograph of the Deerfield River. Here's the hydrograph of the Deerfield River. Here's the hydrograph of the North River. This is the exact same time period. We've got early August through early September 2013. This is just characteristic of an extremely hydro-modified river. We all know that it is, but it's pretty cool to see this on paper. I mean, picture's worth a thousand words, right? If you look at these two, probably the most obvious difference is the frequency with which the river goes up and down. We all know the Deerfield goes up and down a couple times a day. Pardon me, in some cases. But also, look at, okay, let me back up here and go to what's, here's a generic hydrograph, okay? This is what a stream or river does after a storm event. It comes up, this is the rising limb, okay, so this is time, and this is your discharge, your flow. It comes up rather quickly, and then the receding limb comes down rather slowly, kind of asymptotically. It just flattens out rather slowly. So this can occur over days or weeks, that flattening out, if you will. Okay? So in major contrast to what happens in a natural system, we all know that on the Deerfield, you just shut the water on and you shut the water off, quite literally. Okay? So it's not just the magnitude or the size of the peaks or the frequency of the peaks, but it's also the rapidity with which the peaks go up and down. And I can't overemphasize that. You know, obviously, that hydropeaking, that ramping rate, there are obvious safety issues with that, right? And we're working as a group, the FIG group, that is, the fisheries interest group, we're working with the power companies, TU's working with the power companies, to remedy that situation, because safety first, right? So ramping rate should definitely be addressed. But beyond that, we know that the ramping rate and these other elements, if you will, of hydropeaking have pretty significant deleterious effects on the system. So, okay, you guys probably can't read all this. These are just, This is the list of our aspects of river flow that are affected by hydropeaking. We've got the magnitude, okay? That is the size of the difference between the high flows and the low flows. We've got the ramping rate. We've got the minimum flows versus the maximum flows. That is the ratio or the difference in the size between the low flows and the high flows. The timing of those releases, day, night, how many times a day, frequency, how many times a day, duration, how long those peaks last. So we have a lot of variables kind of at play here within the hydropeaking scheme alone, all that can themselves in various ways affect the ecology of the river. Each of these variables in various ways will affect habitat and morphology. Dams and to a certain degree hydropeaking can also affect water quality, probably temperature most obviously, and we'll discuss that here in just a little bit. So we've got a lot going on here as far as the physical system and the effects that hydropeaking and just the presence of the dam can have on the physical system. And then we get into all these myriad biological effects, and I won't go into great detail on these because I don't want to go into too much detail and lose us here, but we've got habitat loss, especially for spawning and for juveniles, okay? And the aspect of hydropeaking that most significantly affects that is this Q min-max ratio, that is the difference between the high flow and the low flow. The larger that difference, the more habitat you have being affected by these hydrologic extremes. You get stranding of juvenile fish in particular, and that's primarily related to the ramping rate, the rate at which the water goes up and comes back down. You've got downriver drift and displacement, and that's driven by both the magnitude, that is the size of the peaking event, because that's going to affect water velocity, as well as the ramping rate. Too fast, juvenile fish don't have an opportunity to get out of the way, quite simply. Then we also have decreased reproductive success as a result of life history failures such as egg mortality. Red dewatering can occur, again, is related to or is affected by these changes in the flow from high to low. And then decreases and shifts in nutrients and food resources can also occur, food resources being the macroinvertebrates in particular. So all of this ultimately leads to lower abundance and diversity of fish and macroinvertebrates in our rivers. So as a few case studies, this fellow Moog, he's an academician in Europe, been studying the Austrian rivers for probably 20 or 30 years. Note here, well, we've got Ontario, but quite a bit of European work. When I've been looking through the literature, what I have found is that these guys over in Europe are way ahead of us on this stuff. They've been looking at these effects for probably 30 or 40 years. Not that we haven't been doing anything here, but the internet is replete with data and studies regarding the effects of hydropeaking in Europe. And it's relatively scant here, relatively. You can still find it. But the most easily accessible information was all coming from Europe. Most of it was. So as a few examples, Moog's 2006 study on several Austrian rivers found 75 to 95% loss of invertebrate biomass in the first few kilometers below a dam due to hydropeaking. 95%. Further downriver, 40 to 60% loss of invertebrate biomass. And further downriver was tens of kilometers downriver. So extensive effects for very distant locations from the dam. And the same trend occurred with fish. Magpie River, Ontario. The diversity and abundance of bugs was actually higher in the river that was experiencing the hydropeaking, but richness and family abundance increased with distance from the dam. In other words, there was still a linear effect. The Bregenzerach River in Austria, benthic invertebrate biomass increased from 15% of its reference condition to 60% of its reference condition when mitigative flows were established. Okay? Another way to say that is that efforts were made to abate the effects or mitigate the effects of the hydropeaking flows by modifying the flow regime, and the benthic invertebrates responded threefold, just about.
Mike, what's benthic?
Benthic means living on the river bottom. And then this Vorderrhein River in Switzerland, through modeling, they determined that both spawning and YOY, which is young of the year fish, Young of the Year fish habitat. That habitat was displaced or dewatered on a daily basis.
Mike, just a quick question.
Sure.
Which ones were these all bottom or top releases, or were they mixed?
Good question, and I don't know the answer to that. I don't know the answer to that. Okay, more of Moog's work. So this was work that he did, relatively small sample size, but we have about 8 or 10 rivers here. On our x-axis, we have the minimum to maximum discharge ratio, that Q ratio. Okay, so at 10, your maximum discharge would be 10 times the amount of your minimum discharge, or 1,000 at max, 100 at min. The Deerfield usually runs min-max ratio of about 5, okay? So the Deerfield would be right around in here somewhere. On your y-axis, we have fish biomass. Look at how quickly fish biomass responds to hydropeaking. It doesn't take a lot more water over your low flows to really start to significantly affect fish abundance. Again, we're running right around in here, and that curve drops awfully fast right at about 5. Well, it actually starts dropping quite a bit lower. Now, granted, this is a very small sample size, okay? And let's also keep in mind that these systems are highly individual. There are so many myriad variables here affecting what's going on that we can't necessarily say with any real confidence that we would expect our biomass to be 1/6 of what it would be in the absence of hydropeaking. But this pattern here suggests that there likely is a significant effect on the fish in the river. All right, so speaking of the river, I think we all know these characteristics. 665 square miles in Vermont and Massachusetts. The river certainly supports multiple and diverse uses. Certainly is one of the cleanest and least disturbed watersheds in Massachusetts. Supports 9 dams for hydropower generation. I don't know if you guys notice here, but there's a rather Sasquatchy looking figure right there in the corner with his rod hanging up there.
Is that Rob Creamer?
It's Nikos Marmaris. Yep. We should all recognize that pole, I would hope, anyway. All right, we've seen the figure already, and we all know what the river looks like during both high and low flows, but just to show the extremes and our daily ramping and those very, very tall and acute daily peaks. So as far as what we know about the river right now, we don't know much. I guess that's all I would really need to say. But just to review some of the work that's been done over the last 25 or so years, and I do need to say that there has been additional work done since the mid-80s. There were consultants to the power companies that were doing a fair amount of water quality work that did include continuous temperature monitoring back in the late 80s. So this isn't exhaustive, it isn't extensive, but I think it summarizes some of the more well-known work that's been done over the last 25 years or so. Mark Bain was a PhD student at Cornell when he did this work. And Mark Bain looked at fish communities in the Deerfield River, using the Deerfield River as a regulated river, and then compared what he saw in the Deerfield River to what he saw in the Westfield River, which is managed as a run-of-river. And what he found was significant differences in the fish communities between the two rivers. And in particular, a very low abundance of what he called the SS Guild class of fish. The SS Guild class of fish are smaller fish that use shallow, slow habitats. Okay? There are about 6 or 8 species in the Westfield River that are abundant there, that were in the early 80s, mid 80s, severely underrepresented in the Deerfield River. Mark Bain attributed this difference to the hydropeaking. And doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure it out. It's because these small fish, things like small white suckers, various minnow species, a couple of different day species, these various species, they're smaller fish, they're not very mobile. When the water comes up and down as quickly as it does, using the various, or being subjected to the various elements of the flows that I just pointed out earlier, They can't handle it. They can't handle the ramping rates. They can't handle the extremes. And so Bain did a pretty good job, very good job at demonstrating that that guild of fish at that period of time was underrepresented in the Deerfield. Now, he didn't make much mention of trout because there aren't many juvenile trout in the Deerfield River. They're stocked as adults. And it leads one to wonder why. Because we do see fish attempting to spawn in the river. I saw reds myself this year, and I know that people do on occasion catch juvenile fish. So it makes you wonder if there were elements of the river that were managed differently, such as a lower, smaller Q min max ratio, slower ramping rate, would there be more opportunity for recruitment of juvenile trout into the adult population? Makes you wonder. Mass DFW, the only known work, or the only work that I know that they've done in the last 20 or so years on the Deerfield was an assessment of fish in the dry away section of the river. And there they documented a wild brown trout population, a spawning population, multiple year classes of fish. So we know that they in fact occur there. I did work in the mid-2000s through a grant that was funded by the Massachusetts Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs. And the work that I did through the Watershed Association demonstrated a very distinct gradient, if you will, in macroinvertebrate community conditions. They were most affected immediately below the dam, and as you came closer to Charlemont, further distant from the dam, those benthic communities started to look more like those that we saw in the unhydromodified major tributaries to the watershed, such as the West Branch of the Deerfield, the North River, and the Cold River. And then we mentioned Brian Yellen earlier this evening. In 2012, he finished his master's thesis at UMass, and his work demonstrated that hydropeaking results in basically pushing, it pushes the water into the groundwater table, that hydrostatic pressure reverses in the river, surface water gets pushed into the groundwater table, and then a fraction of that, albeit a relatively small fraction, about 10% of that water is permanently lost to the groundwater table and then into the atmosphere by way of transpiration through vegetation. So you do get some tangible, measurable water loss as a result of the hydropeaking itself.
That's the interesting thing, that when you think about that in the relationship between TransCanada and Brookfield, TransCanada's FERC agreement is fixed for some time now. And so now this new FERC agreement is coming up for Fife and for Bear Swamp. It's in TransCanada's interest that there not be as much hydropeaking coming out of Fife Dam, because that means more water will be coming down. There won't be as much loss to adjacent groundwater table if there's less hydropeaking. So it's actually in Brookfield, in TransCanada's interest to not have the hydropeaking coming out of Fife Dam. Of course, that depends upon what they're doing up above. So it's really interesting when you start looking at the relationships between the two, and the legal relationships that they have, and then their business self-interest that they have. It's really, when you start thinking about that, they could be fighting amongst themselves on the FERC relicensing of Fife Dam. It's pretty interesting stuff.
Well, Brian, he'll likely be our speaker for the March get-together. So I'm hoping we'll hear a lot more about that here in another couple of months. So we obviously have some pretty big gaps to fill. Including our understanding of the current ecological conditions in the river, as well as the potential effects of the dams and the hydropeaking. So, and therefore the 2013 Deerfield River Comprehensive Ecological Assessment as we build it. This work was funded by a grant from the Massachusetts Environmental Trust with additional support from Trout Unlimited. It included three primary components. A macroinvertebrate community assessment, repeating effectively what we did in 2006, but adding considerably to the number of sites and therefore the coverage of the main stem river. In 2006, we assessed the river from Fife Brook Dam downriver only to Charlemont. This past year, we assessed it at, well, that was, and that was four sites. This past year, we assessed benthic community conditions at 11 sites from the dryway through that reach we did in 2006, and then all the way down through Deerfield. So the most comprehensive ecological assessment that's been done in the river that we know of for quite some time. It was accompanied by a physical habitat assessment at those same, we did that at 10 of the 11 sites. We also deployed the temperature loggers that Kevin spoke to earlier at, I think it was a dozen sites, and collected continuous water temperature data at 15-minute intervals from July through early October. And as far as our spatial coverage, this isn't the best map, but here's Greenfield, here's the Connecticut River, here's the confluence of the Deerfield and the Connecticut. So we're coming up here to River Mile 4 in Deerfield. We had a station here. Coming up here to West Deerfield, Stillwater, station at River Mile 7. Coming up yet further to Bardwell's Ferry, we had a station at River Mile 11. And then at 13 and a half, immediately below development number 2, each of these red lines represents a dam. And we had another station sandwiched between number 2 and Gardner's Falls. And this station actually ran well into the number 2 impoundment. So we have a bunch of physical habitat data and depth data and temperature data from that impoundment, which was rather interesting. This would be number 3, which is right in the center of Shelburne Falls. We had a bug station and a temperature monitoring station there, but no habitat. And here's station number 4 on the north side of Route 2, just north of Shelburne Falls. We had a station there at River Mile 18.2. River Mile 25 is the Charlemont station. 31.3 is below Pelham Brook. 34.5 is at the Bridge to Nowhere, just below that. 37 is just below, immediately below Fife Brook Dam, within a stone's throw of the dam, well, a few hundred yards. 39.5 is the dryway. So some pretty good coverage of the river. And then, as I mentioned, we did this continuous temperature monitoring. And as I mentioned earlier, we try to hide these things, so we spray paint them. And we spray paint PVC, anchor these things in PVC, and anchor them very well to the river bottom using various implements. And we managed to retrieve everyone this year, which is actually the first year that I've been able to do that. Usually something happens if they get lost. Okay, so some early results here. Again, I'm primarily going to be talking only about our temperature results. We don't have much else to report on yet. We're still working up the biology and the physical habitat. Boy, this looks like a lot. Where to start? Okay, so here we go. River Mile on the x-axis. We're upriver here, going downriver. River Mile 0 will be the confluence with the Connecticut River. We've got dams, number 5, Monroe. We've got River Mile, what would that be, maybe 41. There's Fife Brook Dam. There's number 4, number 3, Gardner's Falls, and number 2. Okay, so what we have here are daily water temperatures, daily average water temperatures for each of these 11 stations for August. All right, the red dots indicate our average daily maximum temperatures for that time period. All right, so it's the maximum temperature from each day in August averaged out. Then we've got the average daily mean in green and the average daily min in blue. What I want to show or illustrate in these data is this right here. We've got a very strong linear increase in water temperature right up to River Mile 25, okay? This is Charlemont. And notice how tight the water temperature extremes are coming out of Fife Brook Dam. Fife Brook Dam is right here, okay? Now, I think we probably all know why that is, right? Large body of water, it's cool water. It's just like putting a cup of water outside in a hot sunny day and sitting next to a swimming pool. The cup of water is going to warm up a lot faster than the swimming pool. So the river itself is the cup of water. The reservoirs are the swimming pools, okay? So Fifebrook Dam, it's got cool water coming in, basically acts to, that impoundment, the lower impoundment, acts to basically squeeze or compress the range of water temperatures. As it's in the river and warming through the day, the further down river you get, the wider the swing or range in temperatures. But as soon as you hit the next impoundment, number four, you get this squeezing of the water temperatures again. So each of these impoundments basically serves to abate high water temperatures, at least maximum water temperatures, okay? Which is a really important point to make. Now, of course, further downriver, you're still gonna get maximum water temperatures that are just about as high as they are here, and maybe even a little bit higher. But it's really important to note that the presence of this number four dam actually has something of a mitigative effect on the highest water temperatures that we get during the hottest days of the summer. So if we think about this from the perspective of, so if we want to release water to protect water temperatures, where might those benefits be best accrued, if you will? Where would that water be best served? Well, to me, it seems like it's that middle part of the watershed where we get this immediate spike. This is still quite heavily fished by anglers, but we get some water temperatures that, in some cases, are quite detrimental to cold water fish. All right.
Mike, can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
The high temperature, that's the average high temperature.
That's the average.
So daily temperatures could be well above
yes,
that.
Yes, absolutely. This is the mean high temperature across all 30 days.
Because, I mean, you look at 72 degrees, yeah, that's warmer than trout like, but it's far from being lethal.
Right. So. Well, and here's what trout don't like. yeah, okay, so this is the Charlemont station where we had the logger out at River Mile 25. July 18th, we have on this left axis, we've got discharge. On this right axis, we have temperature. Temperature's in red, discharge is in blue, and we have time of day. On this day pair, by 3 o'clock, water temperatures were approaching 82 degrees.
Yeah, that's lethal.
Lethal. Trout hate that stuff, okay? What I was looking for in these data was a potential relationship between discharge and water temperature. That is, do these plumes, if you will, of released water, do they carry with them cooler water? Intuitively, they should. More water, it's traveling faster, it's going to take more energy to warm it up. And it's also going to make its way further downriver faster. So in any case, I looked at this and I plotted. I had to adjust the data just a bit because the gauge station and the logger weren't in the same place, but these are now aligned. And you can see as soon as that plume of water hits this section of river, the water temperature does this. It does a reversal. Very interesting. I thought, okay, well, is this just, is this a fluke? Is this an anomaly? So I started, I looked at days that had low flows and then that had high flows coming in mid to late afternoon that were also hot days that had high water temperatures. And this pattern held up every time I looked at it. Every time this plume of water reached that section of river and flew over that, or flowed over that logger, the water temperature came right back down. So it really does appear that opportunities do exist for abating high water temperatures in the middle river through releases. Those releases, though, have to occur several hours earlier than they're currently occurring. Right now, I think the releases usually start like around 10 or 11, is that right?
Well, actually, Crabapple and Zor were saying is that they like to get it between 10 and 11, but a lot of times it's sliding into that noontime hour.
Which is even worse for us.
Right,
well.
And that's where something with definitely that there's agreement that if we can get releases around 10 o'clock in the morning, that's
well, I'd argue that we'd want them even earlier because if we go back, you know, so it takes about 6 hours, if I'm not mistaken, for the flows from Fifebrook Dam to reach this section of river. So if we're not releasing until 10 or 11 o'clock, flows aren't reaching this until 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And on hot days, by 2 or 3 o'clock, it's too late.
So you'd want to be releasing 7 or 8 o'clock?
I'd say if it could be done, yes. And this doesn't have to be something that's done every day. This could be something that the power companies would agree to only on the hottest days of the summer. And I don't see why that would be a problem.
That's one of the things that I found in the research that I was doing is there's a, when there was a split between the two companies, there was a question with regards to what are the rights and responsibilities of the companies as far as FERC compliance. And then there was a settlement agreement that's attached, and this is, you can find this on the LIHI application. I think it's for the LIHI application for the Fife Dam. And there are certain circumstances in which Fife said, I'm going to use the names TransCanada and Brookfield for easier because they were known by something different then. TransCanada is legally obligated pursuant to a consent decree in this lawsuit, legally obligated to provide additional water to Brookfield on two separate occasions, emergency conditions and then when mass fisheries and wildlife requires Brookfield to do it. So that's where this organization and Trout Unlimited's relationship with mass fisheries is very important. Because if we can make the case with regards to this kind of data and follow the lead of what is going on in other rivers like the West Branch of the Delaware, when temperatures reach a certain peak or when there are certain circumstances in which the water is needed in the watershed, mass fisheries under the terms of this agreement can go to Brookfield and say, hey, we want the water. Brookfield then can legally then go to TransCanada, I need water, within the confines of what they can do up above.
And that's actually within the current FERC license.
That is within the current FERC relation requirements.
But implicit in what you're saying seems to me, but can you get it clear that from the Fife Brook Reach, say from the Fife Brook Dam down to Mohawk campground, and the way the river's managed now, are there times when the temperature gets so high in that reach that could be lethal for trout?
I'm sorry, Robert. Fife Brook Dam down to where?
Well, the Mohawk campground.
No.
No. So that stretch as it's currently managed is basically good.
Shouldn't have temperature problems if we.
And the dryway never gets out of the 60s.
So, Robert, these are. Yeah, this is about river. This is just below Pelham Brook. Uh-huh. I mean, there's significant warming between Pelham Brook and Charlemont.
Yeah.
It's that reach, and it makes sense. That section of the river is wide, it's shallow, mm-hmm. tends not to move as swiftly, so you'd expect to get a lot of warming in that section. In fact, it looks like this section, I calculated rates of warming per unit river mile. Per unit river length for all of these sections, and as I recall, this had by far the highest rate of warming. So this in my mind is deserving of some attention. But Robert raises a good point, and I would say no. As it's currently managed, these upper sections of the river, this upper section, shouldn't have any significant temperature problems. All right. So, I mentioned this being the tip of the iceberg. What next? Well, this is where it gets a little more complicated, but in some ways maybe not. I believe that what we need to be doing now is further documenting the current status of the fishery and the fish communities in the river. No one knows much of anything about the status of either wild trout, to what extent they occur in the river, to what extent natural reproduction is occurring in the river, or to apply it more widely to wild fish and native fish, native minnows and other such species throughout the river. And so Something along the lines of the of a repeat of Mark Bain's work, I think, would certainly be informative. Perhaps even using something like the West River as a control. Certainly be open to ideas for other river systems as well. We started red surveys this past year. A number of us were going out, and this was a rather casual effort this past fall. But we did document some spawning reds being constructed. We didn't have much success finding trout on those reds. We did see a couple of trout on a few of these reds, but we did count perhaps 15 or 16 of these. And Jim, when were we out there? Like maybe mid-October, late October? Something like that. And I think this needs to be done to essentially connect the dots. We need to establish that trout are attempting to spawn in the river, so that if we get to the point where we are assessing and monitoring the status of fish populations and fish communities, if we're altogether missing young of the year and juvenile year classes of trout, well, it may just not be that they're not even trying to spawn, the habitat's not suitable. Perhaps they're trying, but various elements of the hydropeaking, such as the Q min max, the magnitude, the ramping rate, none of that is conducive to young of the year survival, to egg survival. So a lot of this that's going to be going on moving forward is something of an effort to put the pieces of this puzzle together, if you will. And then we've also mentioned earlier tonight continuing our temperature monitoring to ensure that the data that we're collecting are representative of longer term norms. You don't want to just collect 1 year of data for whatever reason. It could be an anomalous year. For example, this year, number two was offline. So we want to make sure that when number two goes back online and they're generating once again, and the flows change down there just as much or as little as they may, we're collecting data to understand what's going on down there in relation to those particular changes when the hydrology is more representative of what would occur there normally.
If a study like Bain was to be done again, would the Westfield River be a good one to look at?
I was just thinking the same thing, Perry. That was going through my head.
It just seemed like it would be closer than the river up in Vermont.
Yeah, and geologically, it would be very similar, more similar than the West, I would think. But we'd want to look at it. River size, land use, geology, all those things. But it's certainly a good candidate, I would think, on the surface. Okay, so just really quickly to finish up here, just to throw some ideas out here. What could be done, what might be done to mitigate hydropeaking's effects on the Deerfield if and when we get to the point where we're more sure that there are effects on the fish communities and the bug communities? I mean, I think we're starting to build the pieces of this case, or building this case right now, but we've got a little ways to go. The first thing that could be considered is reducing this min-max difference right here, the size of the difference between the minimum and the maximum. All right, anything we can do to reduce that, the better off the fish are going to be. There's going to be less stranding. There's going to be less pushing of fish downriver. There's going to be less habitat loss. I'm not so sure how likely we are to achieve anything in that respect. We might be more successful at negotiating changes in the ramping rate so that when these fish need to move, that ramping rate goes slow enough these fish can move with the water. And that, in my mind, is probably the most significant factor as far as what's affecting, what hydrologically is affecting the ecology of the river right now, especially with respect to the fish populations.
That's on the up and the down, right?
The up and the down, right. Yeah, the rapidity, the ramping rate. You know, so it's not just a safety issue, but it's also an ecological issue. And the thing that's really interesting about this, and I hesitated to mention it, but I'm going to, some of the European work that's been done, and I haven't looked at the details, but it suggests that the ramping rate should be less than a centimeter per minute, which is, to me, kind of prohibitively slow as far as what the power companies may be willing to consider. But all of that is to say that I need to look further into the literature
But this needs to be further considered. What we can do to change the ramping rate in consideration of how it may be affecting the ecology of the river.
Well, I looking through some of the European reports, I know that they've considered everything under the sun. They consider operational changes, physical changes to the river's template. And obviously, if you could constrain the river's width, if you could narrow it up, and if you could deepen it, right, so that you don't have so much of this, but more of this, so the fish don't have so much opportunity to move so far out,
and that's what I'm getting at.
Sure, but pragmatically, it's probably not something that would ever be considered for this system.
It's just cost prohibitive.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. But it is something that
grant money's been spent on. A lot more worthless things than that.
That's very true. I'm with you.
Well, there's no doubt that our rivers and streams are far different than they were 100 years ago, and certainly far different than they were 300 years ago. And by and large, they tend to be wider and shallower. It's not only because our storm events tend to be larger and more frequent, but it's also because with the attendant land use changes that came with European settlement, you have just a change in the hydrology on the landscape. And so you now have more water coming into the river as surface water rather than being retained as groundwater recharge within the larger watershed. It's no longer an entirely forested landscape. Granted, we live in a watershed where we're blessed with a lot of forest here. But nonetheless, there are hydrologic changes that have occurred that have resulted in a river with dimensions that are different than they used to be, wider and shallower. It's a really good point, and it's a necessary one to make, and because certainly the geometry of our rivers is different. So it's not just how the river's hydrology is managed, but it's also the physical template on which it's being managed that also makes a difference. And then this last point I wanted to make, and this is one that may be relatively easy to achieve, and that is just releasing water earlier in the day from Fife Brook Dam so that by the time water would start to warm up down here in the middle river, there would be cool water down here, cooler water anyway, that might help abate some of those problems. So that's all I had as far as results. I do want to acknowledge the Mass Environmental Trust and Trout Unlimited for their support. Rob Creamer, he did get paid for some of this work, but I want to make a point to say that Rob also put a lot of volunteer time into this project. Chris Jackson gave us quite a bit of support in the field, as did Bob Anderson and Donovan Stevens, who I don't have a photo of on here, was also very helpful in the field. And I want to thank everybody who came out to the bug trainings. I realize we didn't have much of an opportunity to collect bugs as a group this year. Certainly hope we can do that in future years. We had a really busy fall for a variety of reasons, but everyone was really supportive in that endeavor, and I just want to thank everybody for their support in this project.
Witness sculpin being stranded on the banks.
Oh, sure.
And it's the more it's up peaking, the more sculpin you're going to have stranded. I know they don't have a